Now we are at Harry Potter book number 4, and it is called The Goblet of Fire. It's an exciting, adventurous story, and it's one that takes a unique turn in the narrative. J.K. Rowling speaks about how when she was crafting the entire series, she knew the shape and the form that each of the books were going to take in abstract, and as each of the books came into life, they took more shape and more specific form. But she knew that book 4 was going to be the pivotal book of the series. And so in book 4, we see exactly that happen. We have more of a lighthearted experience of Harry going to school and discovering that he's a wizard, and encountering this bad fellow, this Voldemort, who is not so nice. And Harry learns a little bit more about Voldemort through each of the previous books. When we get to book number 4, things get much darker. It begins almost at the very beginning when Harry and his schoolmates, Hermione and Ron, go to a Quidditch World Tournament. And in this tournament, after the match is done, there's a bunch of people out partying in the streets and in the wizard camp that is there to watch this big tournament. Kind of imagine it as March Madness for you basketball fans, where people set up their pre-game shuttles and buses and tents, and they're out there partying and having a good time. Well, in the midst of this party, these Death Eaters show up. These are people who have sworn to be in covenant with Lord Voldemort. And they initiate what is called the Dark Mark, and it shows up in the sky, and they start setting tents on fire and going after people that they don't want. They're out wandering around through the celebrants, causing chaos and destroying not only objects, but trying to hurt people. The story gets much darker from that point on. As Harry goes to Hogwarts, he suddenly discovers that there is not something quite right. Something is out there to get him and to try and entice him into some difficult tasks. There's this thing called the Tri-Wizard Cup this year at Hogwarts, and it's a celebration that doesn't occur very often, but they gather 3 schools from Russia and France and England, and they all get together, and each school has one student selected to compete in this Tri-Wizard Tournament. Now, each of the students have to put their name into the goblet of fire, and they place their names into the goblet. And the goblet, using magic spell, selects one wizard from each of those 3 schools. Well, something goes amok during this moment of being chosen. And not 3 wizards are chosen, but 4. Cedric Diggory is chosen from the Hogwarts School of Witchcraft and Wizardry. But at the very last minute, Harry's name comes out of the cup as well. Harry is chosen, not of his own will, but of some dark, mysterious will, to be a part of the Tri-Wizard Tournament. And thus, Harry is thrust into this narrative where he has to compete for some very difficult and dangerous tasks. He must go up against dragons, save his friends from the merfolk in the lake on which Hogwarts sits. And he must enter into a maze where he must face the darkness that lies within. Now, at the very end of this maze, there is the Tri-Wizard Cup. And in order to win this tournament, Harry must grab the cup. And so, in a race, he and Cedric Diggory both race for the cup, and they grab the cup at the same time, and it ends up teleporting them to a far-off, distant place where Lord Voldemort is waiting. Now, up until this point in all the stories, Lord Voldemort is just more of a ghost figure. He's not really fully flesh. And in this dark place, Harry undergoes a dark ritual, not of his own will, but under the will of his dark master. And through this ritual, Lord Voldemort becomes flesh and blood and real. Now he's loose in the world. You see, Harry Potter, in the Goblet of Fire, sets up a dark turn in Harry's journey where things can no longer be normal again. Harry has entered into not just one or two adventures that go amok or something that he can easily claw himself out of through the help of friends or the wizard Dumbledore. No, he has entered into his own valley of darkness, into a place where things are going to get much, much worse progressively. At the end of Harry Potter and the Goblet of Fire, person that Harry has come to trust, person that Harry has come in covenant with, Cedric Diggory, ends up dying. He's lost his life, such in a way that Harry might gain his own life. Cedric sacrifices himself so that Harry may go back to the maze and go and find Dumbledore and tell Dumbledore what has happened, tell the wizarding world what has happened. But you see, the wizarding world doesn't want to hear about this darkness. They don't want to believe that Voldemort has come back, and so they become blind to what's going on in their own right. They ignore the darkness in the world. And this sets up the next couple of novels that we will continue to explore. There are several themes that pop up in this story that I really enjoy, and one of them is covenant, the way in which we engage one another in mutual respect, that we honor one another, that we seek to go on this journey together. There are moments where Cedric finds out what is happening in the Triwizard Tournament and takes Harry under his wing, as it were, and tries to guide him safely through all these very difficult tasks. For no one can take Harry out of the danger. They cannot remove him from the tournament, so they must walk with him through it. See, Harry has to do this on his own, but he gets to do it in covenant with others. Harry is in covenant with Cedric Diggory and supports Cedric by sharing information about the tasks as Harry discovers them, so that both he and Cedric may have some success. Harry is in covenant with the other candidates, the other students as well, and goes out of his way to go protect them. He risks his own life so that he can continue to be in covenant with all those whom he walks that journey with. Even Dumbledore remains in covenant with Harry, and at the end of the book, and the end of the story, Dumbledore talks at a eulogy for Cedric Diggory and says that there are dark times that are coming. And it will be important for us to remember that we'll be asked to choose not with what is easy, but with what is right. Those are important and powerful words. I have another story that I want to share about a young girl. Her name is Sally. She's a bright-eyed, cheery little girl. She's about 3 or 4 years old. And every morning she wakes up and she loves that her parents set out this giant table for her and her mom is in the kitchen every morning making pancakes, especially on Saturday mornings. Forget the cartoons on Saturday mornings. Forget running around and doing whatever it is you do on a Saturday morning. Her morning ritual is to come down from her bed, sit at that table in her kitchen and watch her mother make pancakes. And as her mother standing there flipping pancakes for Sally, she would say, "Sally, you are going to love these pancakes. These are the pancakes that I made for you. They are some of the best, most delicious pancakes in the world." And Sally would sit in her chair and she'd go, "Oh, so I love these pancakes. They are the best pancakes in the world." And mother would come and drop the pancakes on her plate. She would say, "Here is your pancake." And Sally would dig into it, and she would eat it, and she would know in her heart that that was the best pancake in the world. Her mother made the best pancakes in the world. This was her ritual every Saturday. Well, Sally, of course, got older and went to school, kindergarten, and first grade. And in first grade, she met a friend who was really kind to her. And Sally was really excited because one day her friend asked her to come have a sleepover at her house. So Sally went home all excited and said, "Mama, Mama, I got an invitation to go to my new friend's house, and I'm really excited. I've never had a sleepover before. I'm really excited. It's going to be Friday night, which means I'll be there on Saturday morning." And then suddenly Sally realized what that meant. That meant that if she was going to be at her friend's house on Saturday morning, it meant she couldn't be at home on Saturday morning, which meant she wasn't going to be there for her ritual on Saturday morning. She wasn't going to be there to watch her mother flip pancakes and make the most best delicious pancakes in the world on Saturday morning. She was going to miss out on the best pancakes in the world. Well, she got really concerned, and she asked her mama, "Mama, I want to go and be with my friend, but it means I won't have your best pancakes." Well, sweet mother said, "You know that I will always be here and I will always make these pancakes for you. And so it's okay to go. In fact, I'll help you pack your bag and we'll drop you off at your friend's place. And then I'll come pick you up Saturday morning and you can tell me all about how things went." So her mother did just that. They packed the bags, and Friday came, and she dropped off little Sally off at her friend's place. And Sally was excited but nervous. And Saturday morning came, they had a wonderful sleepover, and there in the kitchen was her friend's dad making pancakes. Sally was really nervous. "Oh no, well, these pancakes just aren't gonna match up to my mother's pancakes. They're just not, my mother makes the best pancakes in the world." Well, the dad brought over the pancakes and laid all the plates down in front of the kids who were all there for the sleepover, and Sally, nervously, cut the pancake and took a bite. Oh, heaven! Oh my goodness, the butter, the syrup, the pancake! Oh my gosh! Oh, this realization suddenly dawned on her that this pancake that she was biting into was the best pancake in the world she had ever had. She never tasted such a good pancake in her life. Oh, she was so excited. Her heart was just filled with delight. It was so amazing. Well, comes the time for her mother to pick her up. Sally sulked over to the car with her bag and got into the car and buckled her seatbelt and kind of hung her head down low. And her mother was like, "Well, how was the sleepover?" Sally nodded. "Well, how was breakfast this morning?" Sally kind of nodded. And mother looked at her and said, "What did you have for breakfast?" And Sally looked up with big, sheepish eyes. And she said, "Pancakes." And Mama, oh, they were the best pancakes in the world. Oh, they were so delicious. And then Sally's heart broke a little bit. She looked at her mom and she said, "Mama, I know you told me that you made the best pancakes in the world, and I believed you, I trusted you. But, oh, Mama, you should have tried these pancakes. They were so good. They were just delicious." And Sally tried not to cry, because she knew that saying that might hurt her. Well, her mother looked at Sally and said, "Sally, I'm glad you had this experience, because I knew that one day this would happen. I knew that one day you would grow up, and you would go to someone else's house, and you would have their pancakes. And you would discover that, while my pancakes were good, they may not be the best in the world. But I told you every Saturday morning that I made the best pancakes in the world, and that these were the best pancakes in the world, because I wanted you to know that every time that you would bite into a pancake, that you would know that I love you. That my heart will always be with you. And so whether it's my pancakes that you are eating or someone else's pancakes, when you bite into that and you feel such joy and such gladness in your heart, you will know and I am with you, and how much I dearly love you. And that, Sally, is my covenant for you. You see, covenant is not just something that happens spiritually. It's not just something that we talk about in the church, about how we go about doing a budget, or pay the bills, or show up here every Sunday, or pledge our support and our love to one another. But it's something that is real. It is something that is physical. It is something that is visible. And so I want you this morning to just be in touch with your own body. To feel everything inside of you. Feel your hair on your head, to your shoulders, to the shirt on your back, to how your arms sit in the pew, to how your legs extend, touch the floor. I want you to take your hand and reach out to the person next to you and take that person's hand. I want you to feel what covenant is. I want you to touch another person next to you, because here in this community, here in this space, this is what we mean when we mean covenant. Not just the best pancakes in the world, but that I'm there for you when you most need it. For as Sally grows up, there are going to be dark times ahead. As we go forward in this life, there are going to be dark times ahead. And so we need something to hold on to. We need something physical, visceral. We need to know that we are there for one another. And so in the story that we hear in the scripture today, it's not just about pancakes and butter and syrup, but it's about a new covenant that Christ offers to us. And the story that we hear this is in the story of the Last Supper, the story in which Christ pours out his blood into the new covenant and offers it in the cup. The cup is a symbol of new covenant. And when we drink of this cup, we will experience not just God's love, but something visceral, something real, something that quenches our thirst, something like pancakes drenched in butter and syrup, something like holding our friend's hand next to us, knowing that when stuff gets hard and stuff gets real, that that's going to be the person who has your back, who has your side, who has you going forward. Jesus, in this story, comes upon a blind person. And Jesus turns to that blind person and reaches down into the dust of the earth. And in Hebrew, the dust we call Adam. The dust is Adam. And Jesus spits into that dust and turns it with his hands into mud. And then takes this mud, smears it onto the eyes of the blind man, and gives that blind person sight. It is by taking the Christ, the very essence of Christ in this world, and mixing it up with our very essence, our own Adam, our own dust, to become mud for this world that we might see. This is a strange and odd covenant. It means that going forward, we will get into the mud. That we will slog through some tough, dangerous experiences. We will face our own dragons. We will have to rescue our own friends. We will get lost in the mazes of this life. And at the very end, it may not be a happy ending. It may be something very difficult that we encounter, not winning something, but losing something. At the very end of it all, we may encounter death itself. But it is not our own selves that get us through those times, but rather it is this covenant It is covenant with one another. It is God who sees us through the end and protects us and saves us. He moves us on out of the valley of darkness into something beautiful. And so we take one more step closer to that moment in which God reveals how beautiful the other side of that valley will be. And it will be a beautiful place for all of us to be in covenant.